throw him out the league, but yet you got somebody that got accused of rape and everybody wants to, you know, gloss over and act like it don't happen when more people are affected by this than they are affected by dogfighting.
Yeah, and to add to that, I mean, and first of all, I do think he should have his sentence reduced. Because to be fair, he's been a lot less rapey since he got in trouble. Like, I mean, because at some point, yeah, you got to grow up and you got to stop raping people. You know?
Yeah.
Every man comes to a point in his life where you're like, hey, when I was a child, I did childish things, but now I'm a man. I got to put my childish things behind me and step into adulthood. And even though he is like 30 years old, maybe this is his time to learn that lesson that, hey, can't be going around just raping people no more. So, I mean, you got to reduce the sentence right there. But, more importantly, though, is, like, people's reaction to him is weirding me out. Like,
yes,
when they showed him being allowed to practice and female fans screaming and yelling at him, it's like, what don't you get about rape? Like, this dude is, and I'm sorry, obviously, he is accused of rape, but look, man, OJ's accused of murder, and he did that shit. I'm saying, this dude, to me, is probably on some raping shit. It's hard to get falsely accused of rape 4 times. It's hard.
Very hard, you know, and I'm not saying that every incident is true, but you got 4. 1 out of 4 of these is legit. Yeah. You got a 75% chance that one of these bitches is telling the truth.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Hell,
you can't have his behavior and act like every woman he ever put his dick in is lying. Are you serious?
Yeah, he got, like, honestly, 4 women that don't know each other have accused you of rape.
Don't know each other at all.
I think
that's where my angle coming in. You mean to tell me Michael Vick came and for like 2 weeks, folks outside with them protesting dog sign. And I know people love the dogs, don't get me wrong. And I'm not trying to gloss over his behavior, but it is a difference. And it's amazing how people will want to throw you in jail quicker for kicking and shooting a dog than they will for another human life. That's why I draw my personal lines at.
Heck, you know, Tiger had sex with 19 to 21 different women. Not a single time did he get accused of rape.
Yeah, that is, I mean, come on. There's a lot of dudes. Like, it's weird to me to listen to NFL people basically defend his actions and kind of talk around the idea of he's a rapist. Like, you hear these people. First of all, we're talking about what should be a criminal sentence in terms of a game suspension. That's ludicrous. I laugh every time I think of it. Like,
is he still getting paid for these games that he doesn't play?
No, not the games he doesn't play.
Oh.
But it's just funny to me to, like, you know how many niggas in prison right now wish they could have took a 4-game suspension? You know what I'm saying? If you was sitting in front of the courtroom and he was like, hey man, look, you raped somebody, but here's what we'll do. We'll give you 3 months unpaid leave from your job and you just resume that shit. And we're sitting around debating over, no, it should be 6 months paid leave. No, it should be 5 months. Like, he's a rapist. You know what I'm saying?
And I guess from just my perspective, it just angers me at how, excuse me, more people are not outraged in general public. And I think my personal opinion, it all falls into people's love for the sport of football.
Yes.
People don't want to cover this, but people are so in love with football. It's like, you can do whatever you want to do. Unless I see you hang the body and throw it out the window, I'm not going to say anything.
Right.
And one of these cases, I'm going to have to convict him in order for anybody to actually really give him a true punishment for what he did.
Yeah.
So speaking of Mike Vick, can we, I gotta say, I am fucking sick of people. Every time something happens to another NFL player, we gotta talk about Mike Vick. This nigga is not the pillar of upstanding society. This dude was kind of a piece of shit. Now, he's good at football, and granted, he's a one of a kind athlete and blah, blah, blah. That nigga is kind of a piece of shit. I can't keep, people gotta stop defending him. I know we want to bring up race and we want to bring up like public perception and being vilified in the media. But when you vilify a villain, that's not the dude to take the stand for. We promote Mike Vick like he's a persecuted athlete, and he's not. Like, he was very arrogant. he overstepped his bounds. He lied to people that he knew was going to be affected by the truth. And he basically, you know, did a lot of everything he was accused of, pretty much he did. I'm sorry, man. We can't keep pulling him out like he's the one dude. Like, there's so many other people that have probably had hard luck stories. I'm not stepping up for Mike Vick, man. And other people need to stop that shit. I have a blog post that's all ready to go. I just haven't basically hit send. And it's just about this exact sensitivity of, but what about Mike Vick? What about that nigga? You know what I'm saying? Like, that's like, what about T.I.? You know what I'm saying? Like, this is a dude that keep getting in trouble. What do you want me to say?
That's true. Yeah. And I guess my thing I think the thing about Ben Rutherford is that the people in the little town was like, hey, we know this happened, but we basically don't have enough evidence.
Right.
I promise you, if they would have had enough evidence, it would have went to trial.
Right. Like, the problem with the Mike Vick thing is people keep bringing up race. Like, they keep going, well, look, if Mike Vick was white, he'd still have went to prison.
Yes, sir.
And the same thing with Ben Roethlisberger. If he was black, I wish there was an alternate universe where we could fucking try these theories of, are they really believing that a black Ben Roethlisberger is, like, tased at the club, beat with nightsticks, taken in, hung by a noose, and it never makes the news? Like, what is this alternate reality, man? So, and I brought up Kobe, where I was like, listen, Kobe's an athlete that was accused of rape, and, you know, you look into the details of that, and you see how sketchy those accusations were, and he's a guy that didn't go to trial, paid the lady off, but still, I'm not gambling with my freedom either, but paid the lady off, didn't go to prison, has got his endorsements back, lived his life. You know what else? He's a black man. What happened to this crazy racial society where Kobe was supposed to turn into the, you know what I'm saying, this
monster?
Yeah. He was supposed to be media kryptonite. He was supposed to be the bad guy forever. And people are more upset that he snitched on Shaq at this point than they are about the accusation of rape. So I think we got to take the race out of it sometimes, because we get on a tangent that when there's a whole lot of other hypocrisy in these things, like Karen was bringing up the outrage to dogs as opposed to women. We're a we're a misogynistic society. And we are a lot more comfortable with someone beating up a woman, than somebody doing something to a dog. And that's kind of fucking sad. But anyway, speaking of sad, I don't think A&E should be making it okay to laugh at people with mental disorders. That show, Hoarders,
I don't know if you've seen it. They run the marathon, and people been talking about it all day. That show, Hoarders, is amazing. It's like talking to a grown kid that got the money to buy stuff and keep it for 50 years.
Yeah, Nichelle, have you seen the show?
I've never seen this show. No, I didn't know it was that deep. I was just like, oh, these people will keep the house.
Someone told me there's an episode where they found a dude's dead wife underneath a bunch of, like, rubbish.
Dead wife?
Yes, like, it was a couple who lived in this house. They were hoarding so much. She went missing for, like, 2 weeks. They went to the news. They were, like, telling everybody, like, hey, my wife's missing. Can you help me find her? So they were cleaning out his house, and they found her. I don't know if that's true or not. I have read that story, but I don't know if they were really on Hoarders. But supposedly,
they had that much stuff that she got lost.
It collapsed on her.
It's terrible. Ooh. You talk about people that can't walk through their homes, can't move through their homes. They got roaches, they got bugs, they got possums.
Yeah,
they get to the point where the people that do the health stuff is coming in and shutting their houses down. But like, look, you can't live here.
And they got a show too called, I haven't seen it, it's called Animal Hoarders.
I haven't seen it.
And
you know what? Time to time, you see it on the news. People who have like 53 cats,
and all these horses,
14 parakeets, 10 dogs.
It's funny though, because when I first heard it, I assumed that it was about animals who were hoarding shit. Like,
animals just go pick up random stuff and bring it back to your house.
It's like, this possum has had this cookie tin for 12 years. Like, wow. And then somebody's like, no, it's the opposite. I was like, oh, my bad. Damn. But yeah, that's still sad either way. So yeah, A&E, thumbs down. You guys shouldn't be making me laugh at that. If you think about it, pedophiles are really just people who can't wait to take the cake out of the oven. You know what I'm saying? Like, they're the people that eat cookie batter sexually. You know, if you really think about it, their problem is really that they can't wait for it to ripen. So they would rather eat the cookie before it's cooked than after when it's done, like everybody else would.
Ha ha ha.
Exactly. Exactly. Hmm. It was a deep thought I had this week, and I was like, I have to put it on the podcast. Don't know what to do with that.
Yeah.
Don't think it solves anything with the criminal system or pedophiles, but it is a different way to think about it.
Oh, so you said they'd rather eat the cocoa powder versus the real chocolate?
Well, no one likes the dude that eats the food before it's done, okay? No one likes that.
Because you get sick like that.
Yeah, well, not just sick. I'm talking about, like, if you eat, like, say you're making cookies, and somebody just sticks a finger in the cookie jar, in the cookie batter, and eats some. Hope nobody they, likes that.
Hope it ain't with them contaminated eggs. You will get sick.
Yeah.
Yes, it does make people sick. Maybe that's how that kid got herpes. Why don't people remember the good fans of the teams that they hate? You ever notice that? Like, I hate Carolina. All their fans suck. You know, I was there one time and I was walking on campus and one of their fans spit on me. And you're like, okay, what about the other thousands of people there that didn't do anything to you?
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you don't have one asshole fan in the ranks of the teams you root for. There's no one dude. Like, I'm going to start telling people stuff. Like, when they go, because I'm a Carolina fan and I'm an Eagles fan. So whenever people start telling me stuff like, yeah, man, I went to the Eagles link to the link and I was there in my Cowboys jersey and a dude spilled soda on me, I'm gonna be like, you know what? A Cowboys fan raped my mother. Yep. For no reason. He was wearing a Cowboys jersey. It was uncalled for. I told him, what are you doing? And he just said, how about the Cowboys? And ran off. And I haven't seen y'all ever since. Like, come on, dude. I'm wearing the fucking Tar Heels jersey. Am I an asshole? Are you telling me I'm an asshole? No? Well, then calm the fuck down, man. Jesus. All right, man. So we saw some movies this week.
Yes, we did.
We saw Despicable Me.
Yes.
It was cute.
Despicable Me. It was really cute.
It was a little too cute. Like, it got so cute by the end, man. It was just ridiculous.
Oh, I liked it.
And nobody can adopt kids that fast. Like, he was just adopting kids, giving them back, taking them back. I know gay people was mad as hell watching that movie. You could just walk in and get them? Like, come on, dog. That is not how it works, man. They don't even do background checks or nothing. Anyway, it was cute. Now, I did like it, but, you know, I'm a man. So I had to go see Machete.
Yes! I want to know how that is. I want to see it.
That was great. And it was not great, and it was a good movie, great, but great, and it was hilarious, great.
It is.
Was it like, is it like this? Because I was talking about this with the boyfriend, and you know, he's a Latino. Mm-hmm. And we had just finished watching Black Dynamite.
Yeah.
And then we saw a preview for Machete. And just before the preview rolled, and we had seen Black Dynamite, he's like, man, how come there's no, like, Latino blaxploitation films? And I was like, sorry, baby, you guys gotta come up a little more.
It was. This is it.
Yeah. This
is what. And we were like, and then when we saw it, I was like, there you go, baby. That's your Latino exploitation.
Yes, every stereotype, too. They cover them all, from the Chaco stands to the legal immigration. They get it all in there.
Yeah, they even have, They have so many, like, cliches, bad movie cliches. It is, now listen, I know Karen said it was great. Listen to me, okay? I'm the one get the movie you. Advice from. Love Karen loves job. Everything. Karen doesn't hate anything.
She's a lover, not a fighter.
Now, there are some stuff that does suck now.
The only thing I know that Karen really just disliked was that Tom Hanks movie where he's, like, trying to be some type of detective. What was the name of that movie?
What the hell is
the
that?
The sequel is Angels and Demons. I don't know what the first one was.
I know. Da Vinci Code. Yes.
Was the worst movie ever. Oh, God.
But listen,
that's boring.
We go to the movies like...
Machete.
We go to the movies every week.
Yeah.
That's the one movie she's hated in like 15 years.
And okay? I really hated y'all.
So, all right. Machete. This movie is good if you're the kind of person that laughs at bad movies.
Yes.
And what I mean by that isn't that the movie is bad, but just that it purposely seeks out that type of laughter. Okay? They're making a conscientious effort, almost like The Last Dragon is now. Like how you laugh at The Last Dragon now. But at the time, they didn't know that it was going to be like that. Well, these are people know this movie's going to be like that.
Yes.
So there's a lot of tongue-in-cheek laughs. There's a lot of just like one-liners and things that are almost awkwardly bad to the point where you have to laugh.
Yes.
We watched it with a great audience. Everyone laughed at it. Everyone was cracking up at the right times, which yeah, I thought was amazing. You almost never get a whole audience of people like that.
Yes, and also the best part of the movie was that I almost felt like we was in an audience full of us, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Because people like knew who the people were and would start making comments about the people. Yeah. It was like,
it wasn't us like black people, but no, us like they people knew, who listen to this podcast type us. Like,
yeah.
Like people that saw Steven Seagal and just cracked the fuck up immediately.
Yes.
As Steven Seagal playing.
He's in this movie?
Yes. He's playing a Mexican drug lord.
Wow.
Now, I'm not giving away any shocks or surprises, but he's playing a Mexican drug lord. If that right there, what I just said, if that made you laugh, you would like this movie.
You would love
it. If the idea of Steven Seagal playing a Mexican drug lord, no explanation needed, then you'll like this movie. If you're the kind of person that goes, what the fuck? Steven Seagal's not Mexican. Don't go see this movie.
Please don't.
That's the best recommendation I can give. All right. Let's do some articles.
Okay, cool.
All right. So Karen sent me this article about CEOs, and it's called Stuff in Their Pockets. So it's probably a biased article.
it kind of is, but it was very informative.
I'm going to say CEOs do not come out looking good in this one. My guess. All right. One of the most startling things about the post-crisis landscape is how tone-deaf the wealthiest Americans remain to the outrage over the Croesus?
I don't even know what that
That's above my pay grade. You gotta be a CEO to understand that one.
Pay grade 10.
Wow.
Courses like packages. The award for complete obliviousness would have to go to Blackstone co-founder Steven Schwarzman, who earlier this summer compared government attempts to raise taxes on financiers such as himself to Hitler's invasion of Poland. Silver medals... Silver medals should certainly be handed out to the many executives and corporate lawyers who were grousing last week about the new Dodd-Frank bill, which includes a rule requiring companies to disclose the difference in pay between their chief executive and their lowest level workers. It would be a logistical nightmare. These titans of industry wailed.
Oh, they're lying. I can tell you for a fact that's such a lie. All it takes is an accountant.
Oh, yeah, yeah, definitely, yeah. Yes. I mean, and actually, you gotta find two people, right? To do this equation, you literally have to find two people. I can do this equation. Who makes the least? Oh, the janitor's making $6.95. Who makes the most? Oh, you make $1 million a year. Bam, there's your ratio. Anyway, for the firms to compile this information. Well, maybe, but if you issue pay stubs, surely you can tally them up and perhaps keep a few more workers on board to do just that. The real nightmare will be when the public sees the numbers, which will illuminate just how egregious the U.S. pay gap has become. According to the Institute for Police Studies, a liberal think tank based in Washington. What is a liberal think tank? And why is that like a thing?
I don't.
It's called the Police Studies?
Mm-hmm. No, it's called the, let me see what it's called. The Policy Studies. I might have. According to the Institute for Policy Studies, a liberal think tank in Washington, it just seems like a weird thing to call something. Like,
well, you know what that is. You know what a think tank is, right?
No.
Those are just groups. Like, if it says liberal or conservative, that means that conservative millionaires or people throw money at these groups to provide research that supports whatever ridiculousness they believe in.
That's ridiculous.
So basically you're paying, I mean, not all the time. There are some that are reputable, but for the most part, they're paying these researchers or scholars at a quote think tank to be like, okay, we're conservative. This is what we stand for. Yada, yada, yada. You find the research that supports that claim.
Okay. Well, the average S&P 500 CEO takes home 263 times what his cheapest laborer does. That's a lot of money.
Yes, sir.
While the CEO pay is indeed down from its pre-crisis highs in 2007, it's still double what it was in the 1990s and eight times what it was in the 1950s. Meanwhile, American workers are taking home less in real weekly wages than they did in the 1970s. So much for the idea for that the financial crisis would somehow even things up by wiping out a good chunk of paper wealth for the plutocrats. Indeed, stock prices have surged so much since last year that many CEOs who receive a good chunk of their pay in equity are wealthier than ever before.
Dang.
Yeah. I'm not reading the rest of this, but it's kind of hard for me to relate because, one, I don't really root against CEOs, but I don't really root for the motherfuckers either. Like, it's one of those, like, I don't know. You just grow up knowing that the whole system is rigged, so it's just more like, when you break out the numbers, it's always gonna look bad for them, you know? And I'm not saying that it shouldn't look bad, but just, you know, I just don't have the anger in me to get mad at the fact they make money. To me, it's like getting angry at an athlete for making a lot of money. To me, those dudes figured out how to beat the system somehow.
And not only that, I do understand, you know, people getting mad about the difference in pay, but like sometimes I have to tell some of my coworkers, I said, you got to realize your errors and your mistakes can get fixed. Mm-hmm. I can go in the system and change your errors. The errors they make, folks lose their jobs. Stock prices fall. Like the errors have more weight and clout to the company's survival.
I think the thing that bothers me is I don't like to get played, right? I don't like to get played. That article's trying to play me. That article wants me to get upset at the fact they make so much money and not really what they do. Like,
yeah, they do a lot.
Like, if you're gonna, not even their job, but like, if you want me to be mad at somebody, you need to show me something they've done that I disagree with.
Okay.
I don't really disagree with getting as much money as you can. And I really,
it's funny.
You know, like, if that ain't the American dream, then fuck it. I must have been in the wrong country for a long time. Like, so
I don't like, my thing is like, I don't like it at the expense of people losing jobs.
Yeah, like that definitely does suck.
Like, for example, like, I hate to call out a company, but let's say this. We'll use example of Target. Remember when it came out that they gave money to an anti-gay group, and that came out, and people were able to make the choice with their dollars,
right,
whether or not they're going to shop there. I will tell you this, at some prominent companies, when you're a corporate, they encourage you to give to certain groups that they support corporately.
Okay.
And it's not, and they even break down how much. If you're at this level, you should get this much. If you're at this level, you should get this much. And it's, no one is going to say this unless they come out or get fired or something, but I will tell you, Rod, do not give them as much credit as you do.
That's, yeah, I'm not saying, like, this. That's the thing. It's like, I don't really support them or take away from them, I guess is what I'm saying. Like, I don't think that they're not scum, and I also don't think they're scum for making money. I just don't give a fuck. Yeah. Like, if me getting mad and there was like something I could do that would change it, I think I would get kind of upset. Or if there was just some plan that we had to fix this shit. But every plan that you have goes against all these values that we're supposed to have in the free market. Like, okay, why don't we limit what they can make? Oh, now everybody's bitching about that. And you got poor people that will never see money in their life bitching about a rich person getting his salary limited because his fucking company took loans from the government, you know, or faced bankruptcy. And, you know, like, people are just so backwards on this thing that I just can't get the emotional energy to get upset anymore. And I feel kind of bad, like I'm letting people down by not getting mad, but this shit is not going to do anything for me, man. I'm sorry. So, speaking of letting people down, this is a really sad story. But it's kind of a happy story, too.
Okay.
Oh, God.
Bride's till death do us part story was false, husband says. He disputes wife's claims that she was dying.
Oh.
Michael O'Connell preferred to pretend that there was only today, and to forget that his wife's cancer would probably kill her in less than a year. That's the way he used to think. I had to prepare for her to die, O'Connell said. Now O'Connell says his wife, Jessica Vega, had pretended, saying she had terminal leukemia in order to scam him. Everyone they knew and a long list of strangers who heard her story and wanted to help. O'Connell and Vega were featured in the April 26th in the Times Herald Record story about the many people who had come together to organize a dream wedding while the bride was still strong enough to walk down the aisle. The story prompted dozens of others to help the 23-year-olds and their baby daughter in the week leading up to their May 2nd wedding. The strangers had donated everything from Vega's dress to wedding photos. For the couple's honeymoon, they flew on donated plane tickets to Aruba, where they stayed in a donated timeshare and spent donated money. O'Connell said recently that it was all based on a lie. Vega's health hadn't gotten any worse, and he believes she never had a terminal illness. O'Connell insisted a letter from Dr. Dan Costin that described her diagnosis was a fake. When I was reporting the April 26th story, Vega showed me the letter to verify her diagnosis. Now O'Connell had invited me to listen in when he called Costin's Westchester office and asked about Vega's medical records. Never a patient here was the response.
So he didn't know either.
The doctor didn't even know her. She wasn't
No,
his
her husband didn't know.
Oh, according to this, he didn't know.
Wow.
I don't know about that. I want to know why he's shouting her out now. What, is she trying to leave him now? And he's like, oh, yeah, you think he's going
to
leave?
Oh, it's going to get better. You know it. You know there's more to this shit, right?
Okay.
I haven't even read this, and there's got to be more.
Wow.
He hadn't wanted to look at Costin's letter before, and Vega had said in April that she kept it hidden to make life easier for him. O'Connell said he now wished he checked out the letter sooner. At his mother's house in Walden, he switched on the speakerphone and dialed Costa's number. A receptionist transferred O'Connell to an administrator who sounded exasperated to hear from him again. I can tell you for sure this person was never a patient here, the woman said, adding that she didn't want to keep receiving his calls. O'Connell hung up and pumped his fist. Yes, I did it, he said. Fist pump.
Where's Jersey Shore at, you know?
O'Connell then beat the beat back. O'Connell has said that he's glad to think Vega will live, but he is candidly bitter about being duped. He hit redial on the phone so I could hear the greeting on Costin's automated calling system. I copied down the phone number and checked it against the one I had for Costin. The numbers matched. Vega had been hard to reach. I called her for several days before overhearing the conversation with Costin's administrator. She hadn't responded to messages left on the cell phone, her father's phone, or her email. Her mother, Diana Vega, did answer a letter call. Jesse would never do something so manipulative, Diana Vega said, and agreed to pass on a message to her daughter.
So what, she bounced?
Well, she won't answer people's calls, which is kind of shady if you didn't do anything.
Say that again.
Right? If I didn't scam you, why wouldn't I pick up the phone?
Oh, you talk about lawsuits, man. There are people that'll sue the hell out of her. They donating all that stuff and you ain't sick. You know how many people really are sick?
Well, how would anybody know? Like, why is the husband telling this story? Like, what happened?
Let's see. Jessica Vega called the next day, and she said she had not lied about her diagnosis or the letter, although she now doubted that their accuracy. She said she had a new doctor in the Bronx, and he was getting better away from O'Connell by eating fresh food, exercising, and drinking nothing but water and tea. So now she's all better.
And a vegan?
Yeah. She promised to let me tag along on her next doctor's visit when she was due to have a white blood cell count taken. Vega was Vegas was unhealthy living with O'Connell and left because he was physically abusive, she said. I don't think he really wants to go down that route of me exposing him, she said.
Wow, so now all of a sudden it's abuse.
Yeah, they're exposing each other, I guess. I guess he came out and said she was faking. He's like, listen, I know that you're not sick. It's been a year. You're not dead. I'm beating you every day. You keep surviving. What the fuck?
Wow.
Come clean. O'Connell said previously that she had bitten Vega on the elbow once. Oh, that he'd bitten Vega on the elbow once when they were living in Yonkers. He said that he was trying...
Wait, so they're from New York. They're from the city.
Yeah.
So she's from the Bronx. The doctor's in the Bronx. He's from... Oh, my gosh. Okay. That's all I need to know.
He said he was trying to escape her headlock at the time, but it still led to his arrest and a temporary restraining order against him. He said he also slapped her during a fight at their Montgomery apartment before they separated. He claims Vega had torn up his car, punched him in the face that day because he was kicking her out. I slapped the fire out of her, Okada said.
Ah, that's a fire.
Oh my.
That sound like what a parent tell their kid. I smacked the fire out of you, boy.
So, no trip to the doctor is the title of this last paragraph. After the conversation with Costin's administrator, I called Vega, told her that I'd heard, and asked her again if the letter was real. I really did receive it, she said. It came in the mail. I reminded her that she told me in April that Costin had typed the note in front of her and handed it to her. Vega paused. I guess I did not do that, and asked to clarify. She paused again, then said he did type it in front of her, but he also sent it in the mail. Wow. Get your lie straight. She said we could still go see her doctor in the Bronx. I agreed to go, but said I also wanted to see Costin. She agreed and promised to send a text message with the Bronx doctor's address as soon as she hung up. The text message didn't come after she hung up, and it didn't come the day after that or the day after that.
Of course.
On the day that we were to visit the Bronx doctor, she sent a text message saying she just received her divorce paper and had to cancel the blood test. I have to meet up with my doctor instead. Hope you understand that settling my divorce is more important. At Tiger Suit. Oh, I had to meet up with my lawyer instead. My bad.
Okay, doctor, wait a minute.
Yeah. So instead of, she said, look, this is more important than your fucking article. I gotta go get divorced. The only other messages she sent in that week that followed were about preventing an article and legal consequences. There were no more, so she threatened them not to release this article or there would be legal consequences. There were no more plans for doctor visits. O'Connell said she would fight for full custody of their daughter in the divorce. He's now consumed with preparing for a future, and he had tried not to think about for so long. Life as a single parent. So basically, man, he was just, first of all, shouldn't he have always been preparing for life as a single parent?
He's beating the crap out of her?
No, because she was supposed to die in a year. He married her with the idea you will be dead in a year. Right? Like, so why would he go, but I can't imagine being a single parent. Dude, that was kind of your deal. Like,
he knew what time it was. He fronting like he didn't know she was scamming them folks.
Yeah, I think this sounds like a shady couple.
Just period. Yeah,
you know, who do you want to believe, the abuser or the liar? I lied about cancer. Like, I don't know. Alleged drug deal ends in assault. Iowa City police say a drug deal turned violent when a man asked the dealer for change.
Can I get a rib? Just one rib.
I just want one crack.
I ain't got nothing but $1,000 bill. Can you break that?
I just want 10 cracks. I got $9 for your ass. Police charged Sidney Jermaine McVeigh Jr., 19, and they give his address, with assault causing bodily injury at 5:48 p.m. Saturday in his apartment building. According to police reports, McVeigh and another person were receiving money from a male during a drug transaction. The buyer gave McVeigh too much money and asked for his change back, but McVeigh refused. That is not one place where you want to fuck up change, right?
Get out again.
Before getting your crack, you might want to get exact change, is all I'm saying. A verbal altercation escalated into a physical attack, with McVeigh and his friend striking the person in the face, which caused lacerations, before McVeigh fled the scene. While officers were on the scene, McVeigh was spotted by a witness and arrested. So this nigga was still on the scene. He didn't flee the scene.
He didn't run away.
Idiot.
He really took that they always return to the scene of the crime thing, literally.
Yes. He never left the scene of the crime.
Yeah. He's like, I'm just going to go up the block and just chill and watch it. McVeigh did not have a listed phone number and could not be reached for comment.
Of course not.
They should, all I'm saying is carry exact change, man. You know what I'm saying? You cannot go to the drug dealer and be like, hey man, I need that in 5 ones, a five and 3/4. It's not gonna happen.
You think they gotta tell us?
The great R word debate. Is it ever okay to say?
What's the R word?
Let's find out. As if the nation weren't already shaken by Dr. Laura's wildly racist rant in August 2010, Jennifer Aniston had to go and rock the boat even more by using the word retard.
Oh.
In an interview just a week later, Yes, I play dress up. I do it for a living, like a retard. She joked on Live with Regis and Kelly on August 19th. The audience laughed, but many people around the country failed to see the humor in her self-deprecating comment. That's because she used a word that almost always is almost always divisive and contentious as the N-word. Nigga, please.
Really?
Are you serious?
And she was talking about herself. It's not like she was coming out and talking against people with retardation. I mean, come on.
Let's just, first of all, this word.
I mean, as a potential, like, if I was a potential employer of her, I was like, I would be like, so you're calling yourself, like.
Right.
You don't think you can act for me?
Yeah.
Yeah, like, that would be more of.
Like, as far as that goes, I mean, she could say whatever she wants. But I'm like, why are you deprecating? Now I may not cast you as the lead in that movie.
And retard is a word. Like, the retard is a word that actually does not have to be a divisive word.
No.
Like, there's other things. Like, you can say, like, this retarded her growth. Or, you know, like, whatever. Like, it doesn't have to be.
It is a word. It is a term. It is, yeah. It is, you know.
Nigger is not a term. Like, you can't just be, there's no other way to use nigger and be like, yeah, I'm not referring to black people in some way, shape, or form in a derogatory way. But whatever. I'm not even offended by any of this shit. I'm not offended by the R word or the N word, really.
Wow. We got all these imaginary words? What's
but that? I just know they ain't on the stage.
See, that's the thing. That's the example. Remember that girl was talking about y'all don't get offended at some things that most black people would?
Yeah.
That's the example.
Yeah. Because it's not that important to me, and I didn't know the word retard or retardation. I got family members with this, but it's just for the fact that I'm not going to get outraged because she said it on Regis and Kelly.
Yeah, you're only as fucking vulnerable as you are sensitive. Like,
yeah.
If you're going to be sensitive to this word, then it will haunt you forever. And that's kind of the lesson you got to learn about a lot of this shit. Is like, listen, if you want to stay in that place where one word can ruin your life, ruin your day, fuck you up, then you're gonna stay in that place. But you gotta, at some point, you gotta grow some balls, man. Alright, anyway. And the audience laughed because it was funny. So,
it's not like she was saying it in a malicious way. It's not like she was saying it in a derogatory way.
Not like those dummies at the Today Show won't laugh at anything. But I'm just saying, they still laughed. But, anyway. By what most people agree.
Hey, that's Regis and Kathy Lee, not in Today Show.
Oh, same thing. Do they stand outside with signs and shit at that show or not? Is that one of those ones?
We have, I messed up. It's Regis and Kelly, excuse me.
Kathy Lee used to be a few years ago, and yeah, she's doing her thing now. She's pretty cool.
We done took Kathy Lee. It's Kathy Lee and Hoda now, so.
So listen, is this one of those shows where people stand outside for any reason? Like concerts, anything like that?
No, they pick on Mona Soup all the time.
No, you think of
this is the show where SNL always shows them drinking like wine or champagne and they just get outrageous.
Okay.
It's like 40-year-old girls gone wild.
Okay, well, first of all, I don't watch SNL anymore. That show is terrible. But second of all, any show that requires you to stand outside in lines or hold signs, I mean TRL, 106 and Park, Today Show, it's all garbage. Don't do yourself a favor, cut that shit off. Anyway, because she used the word and so on, blah, blah, blah. But while most people agree on the absolute inappropriateness of the N-word, the public is surprisingly divided on whether or not it's okay to say retard or retarded pejoratively. Just look at the response to Anderson's offhand remark. Plenty have called her insensitive and demanded everything from a public apology to a boycott of her movies. But a sizable number of other people say it's not a big deal.
No, it's not.
They argue that the word in noun and adjective form doesn't mean what it used to, and that it has nothing to do with the intellectually disabled anymore.
No.
But does that make it okay? It probably does have something to do with the intellectually disabled. Like, let's not lie. Okay?
I'm just feeling like if you're mentally retarded, you're not acting
right
in any form. That's what you are, you know? I feel like if you take it that way, it is a little insulting. They're not acting that way. That's what they are.
Yeah, I just feel like people have gotten more sensitive over time. Like, it's like I say with that one example, you can't make some of the movies that were made in the 70s today.
You can't even do some of the cartoons that we can see as children today. Like, yeah. A lot of Tom and Jerry and all those cartoons have been re-edited so much where they would do blackface.
I don't even know that that's necessarily a bad thing, because some of what they were doing wasn't even trying to be funny. It was just simply racist.
Okay.
I mean, like, yeah. I'm talking about actual comedy, not just straight racism. I get that you shouldn't. I agree. You should not be as racist today as you were. And I still think it is a good thing to err on the side of caution. It's better to be a little too uptight about the English language and what words are offensive than it is to just let everything fly. I get
that's
that.
True.
But at the same time, you couldn't make a ton of those movies now because we are so uptight. And that, as a person who dabbles in comedy a little bit, that is kind of like weird to me. Anyway, retard and retarded are so often used in conversations that the Special Olympics and Best Buddies International teamed up in 2009 to spread the word to end the word campaign, asking people to pledge not to use the R word ever again. This is like the NAACP trying to bury the N word.
Oh, yeah.
How can that term that's so emotionally loaded for some become an acceptable part of vernacular for others? I don't know. And I really don't.
I just feel like use the word properly in its proper context. I mean, I don't have anything against, what's her name, Rachel from Friends?
Yeah,
Jennifer Aniston. But I'm like, use it in its proper context, you know. But she was just trying to be funny, self-deprecating. But
yeah.
I'm sorry, retarded people aren't acting that way. That's how they are.
Yeah, it's like when Obama went on TV and said he bowled like somebody in the Special Olympics. And people had an outrage for a couple minutes and they forgot about it. But it's one of those like, yeah, you probably could have picked a better word. But I'm still on the side of who gives a fuck. Like, it's one, like, if it was the N-word, that shit would never go away. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you went on TV
and say, I bowl like a bunch of niggas in Timberlands.
Yeah. That shit would never go away.
We would have had some issues.
Like, they would still be talking about, look, Iron said nappy-headed hoes, and I still remember him more for that than anything done. Like, racism is a different type of stick, man. It sticks on you. Butts arrested in Boo murder case. Potter Township in Center County. Police have arrested a third person in connection with the murder of Samuel Boo. Boo was shot and killed at his home in Potter Township, Center County, on August 23rd, 2009. Kermit Butts, 26, of Madisonburg, is accused of driving the suspected killer to and from the crime scene on the morning of the killer. On the morning of the killer.
Boots and butts.
Yeah, boy.
He was charged with aggravated. You guys need to grow up. I am talking about a serious murder crime here, and you're acting like a bunch of R words.
A bunch of R and N words. Going down the list, ain't we?
Get it right.
He was charged with aggravated assault and assisting a murder suspect and placed in the Center County Prison. Police believe that Butts drove Ronald Hellchild. Oh man, he fucked up the whole the last name thing. To the Boob home and picked him up later in the day, August 23rd, 2009. Police believe Hellchild shot Sam Boob twice with the shotgun, once for each Boob, I guess, and killed him. Hellchild was charged with first degree murder. The victim's wife, Miranda Boob. So I guess these boos weren't together at the time of the shooting.
Wow, I hate that.
Oh, God.
So many jokes.
Is accused of working with Hellchild to have her husband killed. Wow.
Dang.
One boo.
Murderous boo.
Yes. One boo was working against the other boo.
Wow.
Terrible.
Boo fight.
I hate when that happens, man. Police say that they have text messages that were sent between her and Hellchild, proving that the two were working together to kill Samuel. She was charged with conspiracy to commit murder.
Wow.
You think when they shot him that, you think milk came out or silicone?
I don't know.
I wasn't gonna talk about this dude, but this story's old, but this Chinese dude shot up Discovery Place, or was kidnapping people at Discovery Place.
Yeah.
I mean, Discovery Channel. Same thing. Regina King blast the Emmys for being white as ever after they mistake her for Rutina Wesley. Longtime actress Regina King shared how she really felt about the 62nd annual Primetime Emmy Awards in an open letter. According to her, not only did they publish pictures of an actress, Rutina Wesley, and say it was her, but they also snubbed black actors over the years with no sign of improving ahead. In Regina's letter, she begins by addressing the obvious. When it comes to minorities on the small screen, something is not right in Hollywood, she wrote. And if you're wondering, Rutina Wesley is the girl who plays on True Blood.
Yeah.
That plays Tara.
His friend.
Yeah, they don't even look alike. And no offense to her, but
she's best friend.
No offense to her, but Rutina Wesley looked kind of strong. You know what I'm saying? No offense. I mean, if that's what you're into, that's what you're into. But she's kind of strong for a woman, is all I'm saying. Since the Emmy ceremony, I have been going back and forth about whether or not I should compose this letter. I try hard in my daily life not to engage in uncomfortable situations regarding race. Okay, listen. I'm going to read the rest of this, and I really do like Regina. But come on, man. Come on, nigga. You are the voice of Riley and Huey Freeman on the Boondocks. You have been in a whole lot of racial movies. You were in Higher Learning. Come on, don't bullshit a bullshitter. Now, I'm sure you got a good point, but you can't start off with a lie. Like, I try not to engage in uncomfortable situations regarding race. Word, like when you say jail nigga, you gay, or you, like, you can't say the shit that is said on the Boondocks, which is a show that's all about the uncomfortable situations regarding race. And then turn around and be like, yeah, I try to avoid that, except when I'm getting a check, nigga. Anyway, but sometimes it's very difficult to find other reasons that better explain why certain events play out the way they do. It is impossible for me to ignore the published statistics regarding the number of people of color mentioned, celebrated, or honored in the history of the televised Emmys. Up to and including this year, there have been only 53 non-white actors nominated for Emmys, but out of nearly 1,000 possible nominations in the top 4 acting categories for drama and comedy. So that is a pretty low percentage. And you gotta wonder how much of that is also reflected in the opportunities for minorities.
That's true too now.
Cause like, what are you gonna do? Reach and just start promoting black people for nominations just because they black, even if it's only like, well, there's only 10 of them this year. Give all 10 of them another nomination. So you gotta wonder, you know, it's recently has gotten more diverse though. So maybe, you know, in recent years, she might have a really good point. I worked in television nearly all my professional life, starting in 227.
Oh, yeah.
She didn't say that. And that statistic is quite sobering to me. And to add injury to my already sensitive nerve endings, a picture of Rutina Wesley from True Blood, who attended this year's Emmys, had a caption that read, "Regina King enters the 62nd Emmys." No, I wasn't there.
Dang. That really goes into the all niggas look alike scenario, don't it? Somebody snapped the picture and was like, "Here you go, baby chicken."
She says, "No, I wasn't there. Mistakes happen, right? Well, after a few mistakes of how people of color are portrayed in Hollywood media, I decided it was important to say something about how things go down in Hollywood." Regina went on to chide the Emmys for failing to include longtime minority actress Aliana Reid in the memoriam of great contributors to television. Reid played opposing Regina on 227 as the family friend Rose and spent 12 years as Gordon's friendly wife on Sesame Street. She died of cancer late last year. I didn't even know she died.
Me either.
Rose was the wise, cracking, sassy old woman that always looked out the window, right?
Mm-hmm. Being nosy.
Alright.
Yeah, the first floor lady.
Mm-hmm. I see, black people, we need people like that. What happened to those people in our neighborhoods?
They still exist.
They used to be like, "I'll tell your mama you out here selling crack, Jerome." And he's like, "Oh, damn. Put the crack up. No, I ain't got no change. Get off me, nigga." And he beat his ass. Other black actors were also snubbed by the Emmys this year. However, the snubs didn't come as a shock, considering the fact that the previous critically acclaimed series, The Wire, which also boasted a mostly African-American cast, only earned 2 nominations during its 6-year run. Now that's amazing. The Wire is literally the best TV show of all time. I can't believe it only got 2 nominations in 6 years. That's...
You know what? I gotta tell you something about that.
What?
I've never seen The Wire.
Yeah, you fucking up. Now, we friends, so I feel like this is your first opportunity to go out and find the wire, because I do not give out praise like that just wantonly. That is literally the best TV show of all time.
And I do want to see it. It's just that I don't know what was going on, but for whatever reason, I never watched
it. I kind of envy you, and it's like you're going to get to watch it back to back and back. Like, because once you watch it, you will be addicted. Is that, like, it's not like, oh, the first episode, now I'm addicted. It's just one of those, like, the plotting and the pace and the narrative and the integrity of the story. And especially as a black person, you will be like, oh my god, I can't believe it took so long for a story like this to air, where it talks about the complexities of trying to fix a broken city and what people are trying to get out of it. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's beautiful. All right. Hassle and hype over McDonald's menu change. What would seemingly be an issue of capitalism and supply and demand in any other city or any other neighborhood in San Francisco has instead morphed into another battle between merchants and the homeless in the Heights Ashbury neighborhood. The McDonald's at the corner of Height and Stanton Streets eliminated its dollar menu about a month ago.
What? That took out the dollar menu?
What happened to dollar millionaires, dog?
I know.
I hope they'll make that countrywide, because you know a lot of folks won't be going out to eat then.
You got to go to Wendy's across the street. Oh no. About a month ago, making the items on it too expensive for people to spend the better part of their day on the sidewalk in front.
That's why they did it. It's probably just that one location too.
Street people who for years have depended on McDonald's to eat say it's become a de facto sit-lie ordinance. But the franchise owner says he's just trying to make a little extra money. It's a fight over 50 cents plus tax.
I like that.
they had the comment in there, so I wanted to add dramatic effect. You used to be able to get a 390 calorie McDouble for 99 cents, says Nicholas Newhart, a 29-year-old with a Confederate flag tattooed on the back of his head. You guys are losing me right now. I don't know if he thought this was helping him.
I don't know what this article is supposed to have me supporting them or not. I don't know. We'll see. Let's continue.
Because I feel like not supporting them already. You're homeless, you eat McDonald's all day, and you got Confederate flags on the back of your head. We don't hang out in the same circles anyway. Without the dollar menu, it now costs $1.49.
I'm about to say $149.
$149, which is a lot to a homeless person. Also, I don't like that this homeless dude knew how many calories is in the McDouble. Like, what kind of... There's a certain level of homelessness you need to be at where you can give a fuck about calorie counting, is all I'm saying. You shouldn't be
walking... He ain't got nothing but time, but look at that menu while he's sitting out.
He's flipping his paper over. You know they got that stuff on the side now.
I gotta check my waistline.
Yeah, he's like, ooh, I'm putting on a couple. I'm gonna have to cut back to just the regular one burger. And I also don't understand how he hasn't used his talent and put it to good use. Like, he should stand beside the McDonald's menu when people are ordering and tell them how many calories their meal is. If he's, you know, but ooh.
You don't need that other burger.
You know that's 1,590 calories for all that shit you just ordered, right?
Oh yeah, a person.
You gonna get ketchup too? 1,600. Like, how old are you? Yeah, you look like you should probably be consuming maybe 2,600 calories a day. Okay, if you want to lose that gut, 2,400 tops. So you should cut back. Anyway, let's borrow a dollar. While the price increase may seem trivial for Newhart and his colleagues, it can mean the difference between eating and going hungry. Bullshit. Many homeless think taking away the dollar menu is the restaurant manager's ploy to get them to go somewhere else. Management locks the bathroom doors and frequently calls the cops. On top of that, why are they acting like the management is the bad guy here?
No, y'all probably going there dirtying. I'm not trying to be funny. Dirtying up their stuff, running their customers away, is paying full price for everything.
We all want to help the homeless, right? We all agree.
But there are places around the city that are designed for this.
Not just that, but... Where have you ever been where you were like, oh, you know which McDonald's we should go to? The one with all the homeless people lording around it. Yes, that's where I like to go sit in and eat.
I bet sales probably plummeted, man.
Let's go get our kids out of school and they can play in the McPlaypens while the homeless people beg for dollars outside. No one's down with this.
No.
Mm-mm. The speculation as to why I no longer offer the dollar menu for $1 in this location is absolutely false. First of all, you can't call it the dollar menu. Offer menu items for $1. Okay. She said in a statement vetted by McDonald's corporate office, this was a business decision based on a number of contributing factors, and while these items are no longer available for a dollar, they are available at what I believe to be a good everyday value, unless you're homeless.
Yep.
Franchise owners frequently change prices on certain menu items in response to customer demand.
The
consumer price index and other factors, Julie Winger said. Marketing director for McDonald's Pacific Sierra region said in a statement. Still, people like Newhart, who moved from Tennessee to the streets of San Francisco 5 years ago, say they are often hungrier than usual. Yeah, man, it sucks, he said Thursday while sitting foodless on the McDonald's patio with half a dozen hungry friends.
Wow, they still hanging out this joint even though they can't.
Man.
They got to do beating with brooms. Get the hell off their property.
I would not. The only thing I keep thinking is I would not eat here.
No, and that's what I'm saying.
There's like, seven homeless people sitting on the bench.
Yeah, it's like they've done everything short but beat your way in and go away.
Like, you guys don't spend money. You buy dollar menu, and then you sit around in front of his McDonald's all day.
Yeah,
I would raise the dollar menu to $10. Matter of fact,
just glaring at folks.
Here's how I would do it.
If I own this McDonald's,
this is how I do it. You have a car, it's a dollar. You don't have a car, $10. That's how I would roll. So look, we don't gotta get rid of the menu items. You roll around through the drive-thru and you walking. Guess what, bruh? $10.
And you know what? I'm just not realizing. I know it might sound stupid, but this is why they have signs up at some McDonald's that say you must have a car to be served through the drive-thru.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh.
When the cops roll through, as San Francisco officer John Andrews did Thursday, and tell Newhart and company they can't sit on McDonald's patio unless they buy something, they have no choice but to move on. They could buy a 99 cents hamburger, but they say they would rather save the money for a more filling. Oh, get the fuck out of here. Are you serious?
What did they say?
They could buy a 99 cent hamburger, so there is still a menu, an item on the menu that's a dollar.
Wow.
But they said they would rather save the money for another more filling but less expensive item. Are you fucking kidding me? Oh my god, are you serious?
They just being ridiculous.
Yeah, alright. Man throws sword in domestic dispute. Officer responded to a Pendergast Ave in regards to a domestic dispute involving Roger W. Lampman and his wife. The physical dispute had occurred after Lampman realized his wife was lying about having cancer and... No, wait. No,
I hope not.
No, I'm just joking.
Whoa.
A physical dispute had occurred and Lampman had broken items in the house after assaulting his wife. Lampman threw a small sword at the front door, smashing the full-length tempered glass front. Ladies, never date a man that owns a sword. I don't know what this woman was thinking. Lampin's four children, ranging from ages 6 to 18, were in the house during the incident. Officers did search for the suspect, but he fled before their arrival. But a couple hours later, Lampin returned to the residence and changed his clothes as he knew police were searching for him. He slapped his wife before leaving a second time.
Hey!
It was like, bitch, I'm going to the police office. I'll be back.
Wow.
Hey!
Officers were able to locate him as he was fleeing. Lampman was charged with 3 counts of endangering the welfare of a child and assault. He was later charged with 3 additional counts of endangering the welfare of a child for the filthy living conditions of the residence. What?
Wow.
He didn't keep a clean house?
I guess not.
Yeah. I can't believe this.
Too busy being bitches to clean.
I got time. I got swords to swing at people. I got a...
I ain't got no time to clean.
Florida, an intoxicated man who walked into a bar and sprayed deer urine inside ended up in jail and sent patrons scurrying for the exit.
Oh my god.
Police say first of all, how do you get deer urine?
That's the best
question. So you go to the hunting store.
They
use that to attract the bucks. Like if it's female, it's usually female deer urine. They spray it up there and then you're getting them hunting.
So how do they get it? Like, who's...
I don't want to...
Yeah, whose job is it to...
Go into that. Somebody's got that job.
Yeah. That dude makes 263 times less than his CEO. I guarantee it.
You know he does. Out there in the farmhouse. Come on.
Police say 26-year-old Joshua Aaron came inside the Cahoots bar. He was up to Cahoots, all right. Edison at Friday night, 11:30 p.m., began spraying a foul-smelling liquid from a small bottle. Stacy Ybarra says the smell caused other patrons to run for the exit doors. Some step peeing each other to get outside. Damn, that shit must stink.
Wow.
It was stupid. See, they probably spread, like you said, for hunting. They probably spread out in the open.
No, they spread on themselves to mask their scent. Like,
oh,
so deer won't be afraid of them by getting a whiff of them.
It probably still stinks, Tom.
Security personnel got the suspect on the ground where the police found him when they arrived. They found a small Visine bottle in a plastic bag in the suspect's possession. So only a bottle as small as Visine could cause this reaction for all these people.
That's the...
A little goes a long way.
Yeah. Darien, you don't need a lot of Darien. That's what I say. You use Darien, just a pinch, okay? A lot of these people, they're putting way too much Darien with their recipes and it's fucking shit up. The security personnel gave police another small... I love your laugh, Karen. I want to... personnel gave police another small bottle. Bronk told the police the liquid inside was deer urine. The smell from the bottle smelled like something had died, police said. Bronk told, who would think the nice little sweet deer would piss like alien?
Piss like a corpse.
Yes, like, oh, beer piss death. Did you know that? Bronk told police he got bottles with the liquid from a friend named Ricky.
Ricky got it.
Where you get it from? I got it from Ricky. Please, just let me go.
Ricky, the deer urine seller? What's going on here?
Ricky set me up. He's always giving me deer urine. The suspect said he was supposed to get $20 for spraying the deer urine inside the business. It ended up with Bronk being booked into jail charged with disorderly intoxication and public disturbance.
Wow.
Dublin to fine residents for saggy pants. City leaders in Dublin could soon fine people if their sagging pants or skirts expose their underpants. Who has a sagging skirt? Have you seen that in the show?
I don't know.
You might see someone's whale tail or something if their pants are sagging, but a skirt, I mean, that's just straight up.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever seen a chick with a sagging skirt. I've seen
them too high.
I've actually seen like a thong before, like coming out the back of somebody's like low rider jeans, but yeah, never like just straight up like sagging. I've never seen a chick sag. Is that sexy? Who's?
I don't know. That's sexy to me.
I know the Brad is
in Ireland. Is it like Dublin, Ireland? Like they just now got on this style.
It's in Atlanta somewhere. So or in Georgia, I guess somewhere. What's amazing to me is like, I wonder if the Brad is somewhere like, shit, I was just 10 years ahead of my time.
He was.
Dublin Mayor Phil Best told WMAZ TV. WMAZ that he planned to sign an ordinance Tuesday that would fine violators $25 for a first offense and $200 for an additional offense.
Woo! They still gonna flip their pants? And they ain't gonna pay it either.
Because you know, now, people that sag this hard despite the law are good about paying their fines. The rule passed this week by the city council prohibits police from wearing pants or skirts more than 3 inches below the top of their hips and exposing any skin or underwear below. Best said the rule promotes mutual respect. He said not everyone wants to see other people's underwear. Well, I do. Did you ever think about me, Mr. Mayor?
I know.
The rule was, I'm an underwear connoisseur. I just like to know what the fashions are.
I'm glad you do.
The rule has its critics. Richard Moore said he doesn't like baggy pants, but said people have the right to dress any way they want.
Yes, they do.
Apparently, a manual on how to molest children is legal, cop says.
Are you serious?
Whoa!
Yep, not legal, not illegal. It is legal. A 170-page manual explaining step-by-step how to molest children with police in Orange County, Florida, believed that has been circulated for months, is not illegal. Investigators have stated that they still want to know where it came from. You think? I've never seen anything like it. It was pretty amazing when I first saw it, and because how detailed it was. Orange County Sheriff's Department Phil Graves told ABC News.
Wow.
The manual, which was apparently written by someone who calls himself the Mule, is a how-to of child molestation. Even explaining where and how to find potential victims.
Oh.
I was more amazed that someone would be as bold as to create an actual 170-page document that would detail how to do it. Among the many disturbing topics covered, see, they just can't wait for the cookies to come out. Among the many disturbing topics covered in the show is how to convince a victim in the book is how to convince a victimized child not to tell his or her parents. People who are engaged in the exploitation of children are talking about these things and how to avoid law enforcement. Seminole Church officer Sergeant Dan Purcell. Damn, that's a long title.
Yes, it is. And a long ass name.
Yeah, and I wouldn't, yes. In this article, I would say, can you take out the semen part of Seminole? Because this is touchy subject. Deputies with the sheriff's sex
situation. Sorry.
I knew the POS was going to come out. You can't hide it forever. The deputies with the sheriff's sex offender surveillance squad have been, and you know people in the news do this anyway, where like they have these we've read so many of these articles where they have those like puns in there, or like you just like, okay, they know this is a joke, but they're running this shit anyway with straight fakes. Like if I was a news anchor, that's the only thing I could do good. It's like, give me a fucked up story. Let me say a bunch of jokes and keep a straight face and then move to the next guy like nothing happened. Have you seen the video where they talk about the leprechaun that the black people saw in this one town?
Love it.
Best part about that is they cut back to the news people and they're still going in making these jokes and being dead ass serious. But they're like, well, I hope they get to the bottom of this and find that leprechaun. You know, it's amazing that they didn't find it drinking malt liquor and eating chicken. Back at you, Jim. Like, oh my God, this is racist and funny. We personally haven't worked the case on it, but it has been located within our region, Graves said. Graves told WFTV, that it's not a crime in Orange County to send the manual by email or...
Should be WTFTV.
Yeah.
To be honest.
Yes. Well, local and federal investigators are trying to track down the manual, where the manual initially came from. Deputies believe whoever is responsible may have committed crimes against children.
Word.
That is so sick, like the systemic manipulation and mental breakdown of a child, which obviously they're not developed anyway, so it's not really that much of a challenge. But it's just like, dang, someone was like, I am that messed up, and I've been able to do this and get away with this. Let me share this with you. Like that sheer manipulation and sickness.
Oh, yeah. Disgusting, man. But they're out here with us, man, these pedophiles. You gotta watch your back, man. But anyway, watch your back. Hide your kids. Hide your wife.
Hide your wife.
Hide your husband, because they raping everybody out here. All right, man. So that's the end of the show, man. Thank you so much, Michelle. I hope this turns out good. I hope people like it.
I do too.
I hope this Skype, because we want to do Skype interviews and have Skype guests and shit like that.
Yes,
so.
We do.
That's how you're gonna get Brian Plumper.
I'm trying to, man. If he was just stop sleeping, damn, dog. How many times I gotta listen to this album before you?
You know what you need. You know what you need to do to get him on the show. You know when you had your like, hey girl, send me a titty month. What was that?
Yeah.
Like the picture. If you got to get one girl, send you a body part, and instead of Chippy D, just give her another nickname like Woodchuck D.
Right.
And be like, listen, I know somebody, you know, that want to talk to you, but can you come on my show
first? If you want
to
get in the game, listen to this lad. You tell me you don't want this on your porn? Sexy. All right, man. So until next time, make sure you guys call us and leave us a message, 704-557-0186. Also, make sure you go to our website, theblackouttips.blogspot.com. Click on the donate button. Drop us a couple change. The dollar menu is going up, man. Niggas can't even afford to eat right now. We definitely understand if you got to save that $1.50 for yourself.
Oh, yeah.
But remember, we're keeping this podcasting going for y'all. And, make sure you give us a like on Facebook. Just search for The Blackout Tips. Go to Podomatic. And also make sure you go to iTunes and leave us a review. Been a couple months since we got a good review. Who's going to do it? Who's going to be the one to get us to 20 likes on 25 star ratings? Come on.
Woo!
All right, man. So thank you, Michelle, so much. We appreciate this. And
I'm glad to be on the show.
Yep. And until next time, love you.
Love you too.
All right. Peace. We out.
Yeah. I know I'm make you wanna leave the one you with. But I ain't Usher Raymond. I'm the kid that they rush to blaming for the crush they claiming. Who can make them blush the same when I ask what's my name and they yell F-A-B. You shouldn't have even bought her my direction unless she was handcuffed with an order of protection. Yeah! I'm talking reckless now, cause I'm the reason that your girlfriends are your exes now.
I'm the fella that keep them yelling and it's nothing to get them. I don't sweat them, it's what I tell them and they quickly forget them. And I bet them, I get them to forget the day that they met them. And I let them cause I just bend them and it's on them to dead them. But I've been on the move while you dudes be sleeping the coupe on 22s. Keep your shorty sneaking and she won't tell the truth. She too used to creeping when Mike is in the booth. It's the truth I'm speaking.
Any girl I gave it to can't even go love another man. I give it to him like no other brother can. She say my man can barely move me. But boy, you make me scream like a scary movie. On top of that, I'm smoother than the rest of the gangsters. And I prove that dude you mess with a wangster. Damn, homie, your girl is with the street fam, homie, and she ain't fucking with you.
It's a shame you lame, can't even maintain your dames. And it's insane the way that she gave me brain. My pimp game's the same, don't forget the name. And when chicks beat the chain, they just can't restrain. Shorty, don't try to fake it, just up and face it. Your time is being wasted, your man's a basis. See it all in his faces, he's cheap and tasteless. But life is what you make it, just watch the bracelet.
Bet your man can't do it like me. His veins don't pump him fluid like me. He's nowhere near like me. And he probably been keeping you in check.